Ascent TV is proud to present Faith Collective, presented by Sheikh Hanif Mohammed.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the first installment of the Faith Collective. My name is Hanif Mohammed, and I'm your host. On this show, we'll discuss the importance of dawah, and we'll try to help our Muslim brothers and sisters with any dawah issues that they may have. Dawah is a very important part of Islam. Unfortunately, we as Muslims have dropped the ball as far as doing dawah. When you go and you ask most Muslims why it is that they don't do dawah, the first excuse they use is, dawah is for the sheikhs, for the imams, or for the learned men. But in all actuality, dawah is for everybody. Or they say that I don't have the knowledge to go out and speak to anybody, or I don't know how to do dawah. The purpose of this show is to give you the confidence and give you the processes that's needed to give effective dawah. In order to give good information on any subject, you have to first know about that subject. Dawah is no different. And before we get into how to do dawah or how to give dawah, first, let's give you a definition of dawah. Dawah is simply to invite or summon someone to something, and in Islam, it is to invite to the way of Islam. Now, in order to give dawah, we don't have to be experts on Islam. We don't have to be sheikhs, we don't have to be imams, anything like that, but we have to possess general information. We have to be able to define a few things, and those things are our concept of Allah, Islam, and what a Muslim is. Next, we have to know a few things also, and they are, we must know our Prophet, his book, his mission, and who is responsible for the continuation of that mission. If we were to understand these few words and gather a few concepts and master them, we'll be well on our way on our mission of giving dawah. Now, first, let's explain our concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The term Allah means, and it definitely comes from two words, and the two words are Al and Ilah, which means the only one worthy of praise. Allah is the absolute, the originator, uncreated, creator, evolver, and sustainer of all the worlds. He is the one without whom everything will cease to exist. He has said of himself in the Quran, say he is Allah, the absolute one, needless, the eternally besought of all. He begets not, nor is he begotten, and there is absolutely nothing that can be compared to him. Now that we have a general understanding or a general idea of what Allah is, let's go further and define what Islam is, or give a general definition for Islam. And Islam is defined as, among many things, peace, total submission, and surrender to the will of Allah. Now, it is a misconception that Islam started 1400 years ago in Arabia by our Prophet Muhammad. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. The truth of the matter is that Islam has been with us from the very inception that man has been here on earth. Man was given guides, and he was given 124,000 prophets before our Prophet Muhammad, and he's the last. Now, every nation and every people had a guide. If they didn't have a guide, then God would be unjust to want us to do right, and he didn't send us anybody to show us or tell us what we have to do and how it is that we could be right with him. He confirms this in the Quran by saying, verily, we have risen in every nation a messenger proclaiming, serve Allah and shun false gods. Now that we have an understanding of that, and we know that Islam was sent to every nation, now we have to know, how is it that we define the word Muslim? And a simple definition for the word Muslim is, one who willfully submits his will to the will of Allah. Now, who's the prophet in Islam? Our prophet is the Prophet Muhammad. And of our Prophet Muhammad, we read, he is the prophet that was prophesied by all previous prophets. He is the beloved of Allah, whom Allah chose to complete and convey the message of Islam to mankind. He is the seal of the prophets. There are none to come after him. He is the one whose enemies named the truthful and the trustworthy. Most prophets, when they come into this earth or other religions, you find that a prophet comes with a book or a manual to instruct man on what's right and what's wrong. Our prophet is no exception to this. The book of our prophet is the Holy Quran. And of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "This is the book, and it is guidance sure, without doubt, to those who fear Allah. Allah has also informed us who it was revealed to and what it came to do. He said, 'Blessed is he who sent down the Furqan upon his servant, that he may be a warner to the nations.'" In a commentary to this verse, we look towards Ayatollah Puya, and he gives us a good definition of what this verse means, because when we discuss certain things or we give words that are not in the English vernacular, we'll try to explain them the best we can so that we can all have a better understanding. The commentary states that the Furqan is that by which we can judge clearly between right and wrong and distinguish between the truth and the false. The Quran, Furqan, is the standard criterion to distinguish between right and wrong. He continues, "The Quran is revealed to the Holy Prophet as a light and guidance to show the right path, the religion of Allah, to all mankind in every age." This becomes very important that we understand how this goes about, because if our prophet is the last prophet, then the book that he sent is the last book. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this book that this book is the criterion. It is that in which you judge what is right and what is wrong. When we look into other holy books, we'll be able to distinguish what they have in their books that is right and what they have in their books that are wrong. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us something special in Islam. We have the only book that Allah says that he was going to protect. No other book says that God is going to be the protector of that book. The Holy Quran says, "We have without doubt sent down the message, the Quran, and we will surely, assuredly guard it from corruption." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a hope. He gives us the certainty that our book wouldn't become like the Bible or the Torah, which has been tampered with over the years. Now that we have an understanding of those terminologies, what we have to understand now is, what is the mission of our prophet? And the mission of our prophet is, to invite all to the path of Allah, exhorted mankind to the pure monotheistic worship of Allah, which is Tawheed. To explain to man that Allah has no equals, partners, associates, or children, to enjoin the right and forbid the evil. He was sent to protect the rights of all, great and small. He was sent to deliver the message of Al-Islam. Now, the thing that has to happen is, and things we have to understand is that the message of Islam did not start with, nor did it end with, our Holy Prophet. Let me clarify that. Revelation, God sending his message to mankind, is over with the Holy Prophet. But we have to have those who will come down and explain those verses to us so that we can stay on the straight path. And the ones that are responsible for that will be the imams from the household of the Prophet. And we read about our imams. An imam is a divinely appointed successor to the Prophet Muhammad that has been endowed with the knowledge of the Prophet, but he has no prophethood in him. He is our guide after the Prophet. These guides were spoken of in the Bible and a hadith, which are the traditions, sayings, and actions of the Holy Prophet. The job of our imams is to make sure that the revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down to his Prophet Muhammad are actually interpreted the right way. Because where the Quran cannot be tampered with, the way that it is interpreted can. So these imams will make sure that we stay on the straight path, or the Sirat al-Mustaqim. The Muslim Ummah, or the Muslim communities, have two guides. And those guides are the Quran and the life example of the Prophet and the imams of his household. The tradition shed light on the meaning of the Quran because they are the ones that are personified the command of Allah. There are 12 imams, and we live in the age of the final imam from the Prophet's house. He is the awaited reformer, and he is guiding us from behind the veil through our scholars. Now, this is very important. We have to know who the imam of our time is, and the imam of our time is Imam Mahdi, ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. Now, he's the one who's guiding us now, and in order for us to really truly be guided, we have to educate ourselves on who he is. And if we understand the imamah of the successors of the Prophet, this makes our job of doing dawah that much easier. The next in line to guide us would be our scholars. And our scholars are very important because according to the ahadith from our Holy Prophet or the tradition of sayings from our Holy Prophet, he says that the ulama or the learned men from his community will be of a higher status than the prophets from Bani Israel, or from the prophets of the Jews. This only makes sense, because they have more knowledge. They have a bigger task than those prophets did. Will they be rewarded more? I don't know. I'm not saying that, but what I am saying is that they will be regarded as higher. The next group to uphold the mission of our Prophet Muhammad is us, ourselves. And unfortunately, we're the ones who give Islam a bad name. Because we don't do those things that we are supposed to do as Muslims. And we think people are supposed to look at us in a good way. But inshallah, by the end of this series of shows, we'll have our act together and we'll no longer be the sore thumb in Islam. We have been given a command to do dawah. And that command is, this is my way. I call to Allah. And those who follow me, being certain, and glory be to Allah, and I am not one of the polytheists. Now what happens is that our Prophet has told us that he's been commanded to call to the way of Allah. What we're supposed to do as Muslims is we're supposed to follow his example. This was a part of his sunnah. This is a part of his tradition. And because it was a part of his tradition, we have to make it a part of our tradition. And not only that, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it incumbent for us to do so. He's given us a command of obedience. And it says, whoever obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah. And that's very important. We cannot take for granted how important it is for us to obey our Prophet. Our Prophet called to the way of Allah. So we must do it too. Here's another verse giving us the command to go out and do dawah. And it says, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious. For thy Lord knoweth best who have strayed from his path and who receive guidance. Now, on this verse, there's a commentary that was given by Nasir Mukarram Shirazi. And the commentary is, Islam is non-racial, universal, and has the best and most natural law, rules, and regulations. This makes Islam the easiest way of life to go out and propagate. Because Islam doesn't see races. Islam doesn't see social economics. All Islam sees is the goodness of a person's heart. And we could see through the companions of the Prophet that Islam was for everyone. The non-Arabs, like Ahmad ibn Yasa, Sumaya, Miqdad, Salman al-Farsi, and Bilal, to name a few. All of these were prominent companions, and they had prominent positions, and they did a lot to promote the deen of al-Islam. So we too have to promote the deen of al-Islam, or the religion of Islam. Now, according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, there's a criteria to see who is the best nation of all. And that criteria is, you are the best of nations raised up for the benefit of men who enjoin what is right and forbid the wrong and believe in Allah. And if the followers of the book had believed it, would have been better for them. Of them, some are believers and most of them are transgressors. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here is that we as Muslims are the best of all communities raised for the benefit of mankind. But there's a criteria to it. He says that we're the best only if we enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong and spread Islam. If we don't do that, then we can't be the best. We'll become like those who were before us, of the people of the book. It says some of them are believers, but most of them are not. Inshallah, we will not fall into that category. The Holy Quran says, who's the best in speech? And it says, who is better in speech than one who calls men to Allah, works righteousness, and says, I am of those who bow down to Islam? If we want to be eloquent speakers, if we want to be those people when people go out and they say, hey, you know, you should listen to so-and-so because they have good speech. You can only have good speech if you invite people to Islam, to come to Islam and bow down in Islam. If you don't do this, you can never be the best in speech. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells us that there should always, and from among you, there should be a party who invite to do to good and enjoin what is right and forbid the wrong. And these it is that should be successful. Now here we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there should always be a group that goes out and enjoin what is good and forbid what is bad. But this in no way makes you exempt from going out and doing dawah yourself. You have people that will be professionals at giving dawah. And what I mean by professionals, I'm not saying that this is their life, but what they do is they get in study groups together, and if you want to bring someone to the masjid or to your center to further help people once you've given them the initial dawah, these are the people that you will bring them to. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just didn't give us the command to give dawah, but he also gave it to his prophet. And we find this in the Quran, when Allah says, O people, surely I am the messenger of Allah to you all, of him whose is the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. There is no God but he. He brings to life and causes to die. Therefore believe in Allah and his messenger, the Ummi prophet who believes in Allah and his words, and follow him so that you will walk the right way. And it also says of our Prophet, we have not sent thee, but as a universal messenger to men, giving them glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most men understand not. What happens here is that our Prophet has been given the big responsibility of going to give da'wah to the whole entire world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he was a warner to the people. So we too have to warn the people. That has a twofold meaning. Number one, we have to be willing to warn the people. And number two, to know that even if we warn them, that not everybody is going to accept Islam. Now, there was a word that was used in the first verse that I had given, and that word is ummi, and it means unlettered. Some people will tell you that our Holy Prophet was illiterate. But the term ummi doesn't mean illiterate. What it actually means is that he never went to any schools or any places of higher learning to be taught Islam. He was taught Islam directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we as Muslims, we really don't understand the big responsibility that our Prophet had. But in a commentary or some notes that I have for you, this is what our Prophet's responsibility is. We living in this age may not truly understand the great responsibility of our beloved Prophet, but alhamdulillah, he did. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, called the leaders of his time to the faith of Islam. He did this in the seventh year of Hijrah by sending ambassadors to Iran, Byzantine, Ethiopia, Egypt, Yemen, Bahrain, and Hira, or Jordan. He sent great men to deliver letters to these leaders, of which all began, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which is in the name of Allah, who is the beneficent and the merciful. And he announced his own position. He said, Muhammad as the messenger of Allah, invited them all to the worship of Allah and warned them of the consequences of not submitting to Allah. The formula was simple and should be employed by us today. Our Prophet, what can be said for him? A lot of times when we go give da'wah, we say, you know, that person over there, we don't want to give da'wah to him because, you know, they may be too high. Might be the president of the school board. We don't want to give them da'wah. It might be the mayor. We don't want to give them da'wah. But our Prophet went out and he gave da'wah to the heads of state during his time. Shouldn't we be doing the same? Everybody should hear this message of Islam. And for doing such a good job, or for us having such a big responsibility, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to give us a great reward. And the reward for giving da'wah can easily be summed up in Surah Asr. And Surah Asr reads, in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I swear by the time, most surely man is in loss, except for those who believe and do good, and enjoin on each other truth, and enjoin on each other patience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there are four things in this surah that we have to do in order to achieve salvation. The first of the four is, we must have faith, the belief in Allah, His attributes, belief in the hereafter, and reckoning, reward and punishment, the divine books and prophets, as well as their successors. The second thing that we have is good deeds. Good deeds are adorations, charity for the sake of Allah, jihad, which most people misinterpret as holy war. The better meaning is struggle. In a tradition from the Prophet, he had returned from a war back to Medina and said to his companion, now the greater jihad begins. That companion asked our Holy Prophet, Rasulullah, O my Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, I thought we just fought. I thought we just left the greater jihad. Our Prophet said to him, no, the greater jihad starts now, because the greater jihad is the jihad that you have, or the struggle that you have within yourself every day to do what's right. The struggle to pray, the struggle to take care of your family, the struggle to be truthful, the struggle to fast, the struggle to pay zakat or to purify yourselves. This is the real struggle. This is a struggle that happens every minute of every day in every human being's life. So if you hear somebody talking about jihad in terms other than this terms, they're not telling you the truth. The third thing that we have to have is to enjoin or recommend to one another truth. This includes both enjoining the good and forbidding the wrong, and guiding with teaching the ignorant, of admonishing the neglectful, and encouraging preaching faith together with good deeds. And lastly, to exhort each other to patience. We all go through hard and difficult times. Here Allah tells us to practice faith with patience and constancy. As we can see, in order to obtain the reward salvation, we must give dawah. Now what we wanted to do here was to give you tools, or give you an introduction to what dawah is. To first define dawah, to give you words that you can use while giving dawah, to give you concepts of giving dawah, to show you the commands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us to do dawah, to show us that obedience to the messenger is obedience to Allah, to show that our prophet was commanded to give dawah, and he gave it. And nations came to accept Islam because of the dawah that he had given. And also to give us our reward for giving dawah, which is salvation. In order to obtain salvation, we have to have faith. We have to enjoin on each other to do good and patience and constancy. If we don't do these things, we fail as Muslims and we won't be able to obtain salvation. So inshallah, as we end our first episode of the Faith Collective, I'd like to let you know or share with you a hadith from Imam Ja'far Sadiq, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. He said, half a knowledge is to say, I don't know. So as you guys prepare to go out and give dawah, you may come across people that give you questions and you just don't know the answers to them. Don't worry about it. Just say, look, I don't know. I'll go and I'll find the answers for you. And the next time I see you, I'll be glad to give them to you. Well, I tell you what, if you have hard questions about dawah, please send it in to the email that you see there. And we'll get those questions and those problems answered for you. Because this is the show, this is the people show. This is where we help you with your dawah issues. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to share with you one last thing and then we're going to end. The companions of Rasulullah, when they would leave each other, they understood the importance of Salatul Asr. Because in Salatul Asr, it gave us a formula for salvation. So that when they would leave one another, they would always recite Suratul Asr. So this is a tradition that we'll do here on the Faith Collective. So inshallah, in closing, I close with Suratul Asr. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wal Asr. Inna lisana lafi kusr. Ila ladina aminu wa amilu salihati. Wa tawasu bil haqi wa tawasu bis sabr. Shukran jazila. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Copy, duplication, distribution, and broadcast of this program is strictly prohibited by law without the express written consent of Ascent TV. All rights are reserved to Ascent TV. For more programs like this, visit us online at www.ascenttv.net. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.